I have a tough one for you. I have a good question.
All right.
I want to see.
Well, let me drink some water first.
Yep. So you mentioned it. We briefly talked about it. I think you know what I'm going to ask, probably, right? So what are your thoughts on Tmux?
Oh, I don't know anything against Tmux in particular, but terminal multiplexers as a whole, I think are a bad idea. The reason is quite simple. There are two reasons. One is, a terminal multiplexer works, I mean, it is the traditional type of terminal multiplexer like Tmux, works by essentially implementing a terminal inside a terminal. So every byte of data that comes from the actual terminal application has to be interpreted by two terminals. Now, obviously, this is a doubling of, you know, the cost, the halving of performance, doubling of CPU cost, whatever. I mean, this can't be avoided. No matter how well Tmux designed it, you know, it is two terminals in the end. So that is one obvious problem with terminal multiplexers. The other more insidious problem that most users may not realize or care about even is that it makes it much harder to design new features into the terminal ecosystem, because the terminal multiplexers, like I said, they're a second terminal, right? So if somebody is using, say, Kitty and Tmux, for a feature to work well, it has to be supported by both Tmux and Kitty. And only if both of them cooperate and both of them implement that feature, does that feature actually end up in the hands of the end user. And it's worse than that. And that's because a terminal multiplexer works by essentially rewriting the escape codes that move between the terminal and the terminal program. So it has to do that because, you know, it splits up the screen, but the terminal doesn't know the screen has been split. The terminal program doesn't know the screen has been split. So, you know, they are both as working on the assumption there's a single screen. But to somehow make that into two screens, all, you know, movement, things like, say, like a command to move the cursor to the end of the line, a simple command, or say the beginning of the line, even simpler, that's the carriage return. That's just a single character, right? Supposing you're in the right-hand side pane of a Tmux split. Now, if Tmux passed that carriage return character unmodified to the terminal below it, the cursor would actually move to the beginning of the left pane. But the program that's running the right pane would have expected it to move to the beginning of the right pane. Like, that's its window. So Tmux has to actually intercept that escape code and, you know, change it to something else. It changes it to a cursor movement code that actually moves the cursor to the beginning of the right pane, which is actually the middle of the screen as far as the actual terminal is concerned. And this is just the simplest possible thing. It's the carriage return, you know, it's a really simple escape code. There are far more complicated escape codes. Like I told you a little bit about the Kitty graphics protocol and Unicode placeholders and kind of hacks that we have to do to get it to work with Tmux. So, you know, it imposes that kind of cost on the entire ecosystem. It becomes much harder for new features to be developed and to propagate. You know, it ends up being like there is just a couple of gatekeepers for these features. So, like, if I want to implement some feature in my terminal and make it available to my users, if my users are using Tmux, I can't do it because unless I can convince the Tmux developers to agree with me and implement that feature too. I mean, I can try to do some hacks like I did with the graphics protocol, but, you know, that's suboptimal for obvious reasons. I think that terminal multiplexers are a sort of drag on the ecosystem's evolution as a whole. So that is one of the other reasons that I think that terminal multiplexers are not a good idea. And finally, a terminal is really a giant state machine. There's like a huge amount of state. You know, the current text color, the, you know, the decorations, the underlines, the, you know, various little knobs that change what happens when you receive escape codes. I mean, I'm not going to go into details, but there's like a huge amount of state that every terminal maintains. And a terminal multiplexer not only maintains the state itself, it has to translate this state between its own state into some kind of state that works with its host terminal. And each host terminal is slightly different. You know, they have slightly different behaviors, quirks, features. And so the terminal multiplexer has to bridge between them. It's like an insanely complex problem. You're sort of bridging two, you know, slightly disparate states, very complex states, very large states. And you do it robustly. And so, you know, if you go to any terminal program, or sophisticated terminal programs, a bug tracker, and you search for, say, Tmux, you find a whole bunch of bugs that occur only inside Tmux.
Yeah, not when they run in the host terminal. Yeah, I have experience.
That's kind of the practical consequence of what I'm saying. I mean, I'm saying it abstractly, like state machine, and you know, it has to bridge things. But the practical consequence is there are a lot of bugs that happen because, you know, the program has to run inside a terminal anyway, a terminal multiplexer. And that terminal multiplexer itself is running inside a terminal anyway. And it's just an extra layer that, in my opinion, is not worth the cost. So like if I were to design a multiplexer myself, and this is on my to-do list at some point, I might end up doing it, I would not try to split a single TTY into multiple windows. Instead, I would delegate the window management to the terminal and have a dedicated TTY per window. So this is much more robust. It doesn't require all the, you know, like for example, the carriage return thing that I said. It just works automatically. So the downside of this is that my multiplexer will only work with, you know, one or two terminals because, you know, it requires features from the terminal which different terminals may not have. So like for example, Kitty doesn't have this, but Western has its own multiplexer, which you can use as an alternative to Tmux. So I don't know the details of how that works, but I'm guessing it's something similar. And so if I were ever to make a multiplexer, so main use case of multiplexers really is the remote persistence use case. So, you know, you SSH into a server and your network connection is flaky, so it could go off any time. If you lose it, if your network drops, you don't want to lose your session. You know, the running program shouldn't end and so on. So that's the one thing that I would still say that Tmux is somewhat useful for. I mean, for the local use case, I'm of the opinion that multiplexers are completely an anti-pattern. You can do everything that you can do locally without the multiplexer, just as well, if not better. But for the remote use case, there's still, you know, I can see the use case. I personally don't use it. I have other ways of dealing with this problem, but I can see that it can be useful. So if I were to design a multiplexer, what I would do is I would make it, you know, cooperate with this host terminal so that the windowing and the splitting of this, you know, the screen, the multiplexing part is managed by the terminal, and only the session persistence part is managed by the actual multiplexer program. So yeah, it's separation of concerns. I mean, it is the terminal's job after all to, you know, put up windows and interact with them and whatever. So let the terminal do that and let the multiplexer focus on the session persistence, which is what it needs to do.
Yeah.
So, that would be my approach.
I have a question for you there. The reason why I use Tmux, I don't care about servers because I don't, you know, my servers are locally. I SSH into them. If I lose the connection, I don't care, right? It's fine.
Right.
That part about Tmux is not important for me. If it's a remote server, I lose the connection, I just SSH into it again, fine. I don't mind about that too much. But what I use Tmux for is sessions, right? With the keyboard shortcut, right? Three keys that I press on my keyboard, I jump to my dotfiles. If I press another shortcut, I jump to my whatever project A. Another key, I jump to GitHub repos. Each one of them is a GitHub repo, which is a Tmux session. That is the only reason I use Tmux sessions.
So you can completely replicate that using scriptable terminal. So I of course say Kitty, but I suspect you can do the same with, say, for example, Western. So you can have so Kitty has a, like I said, a remote control API. So let me just show you that on my
I'll switch to your screen.
Stream.
So can you ask Kitty, okay, is this session running? If it is running, just switch to it. Do not create it.
Yes.
Or
yes.
Because that's
yes,
the main yes, thing, yes, you know.
Yes. So for example, so Kitty has a ls command. Okay, so let me show it to you in an actual terminal rather than browsing the documentation.
Okay.
So I'm starting Kitty. I'm giving it that I'm to allow the board control. So here you see I have started the Kitty. Now let me create a couple of windows. Supposing in one window I run cat, just as an example. And now I want to check if cat is running. So you can run this command kitten at ls. So what this does is it it outputs a whole bunch of data in JSON format about what windows are running. So you can see in here somewhere there'll be a window one and window two, and somewhere in there there'll be a so you can see here the title so you can see here the foreground processes. So you can see here this window is running the kitten at ls command, but the next window will be running cat. So you can easily query this using any tool like JQ or whatever. You have that you have that information at your disposal, and then you can run a command like kitten at show focus window, and you switch to that window. So you know, these are, I'm showing you the building blocks. I'm not showing you a ready-made solution. You have already own script and so on, but the building blocks are there. You can do all this kind of thing. I mean, I myself use these in my workflows sometimes, and and like I showed you in the integrations page,
but this is panes, right? I don't use panes too much. Yes. I use sessions. So a session occupies the entire screen for me. I switch to the other session.
So these are called OS windows in Kitty. It can focus tabs. That's the whole screen. Showing it here, but you can also use it to focus OS windows. That's so like if you're using like a like Hyperland or some kind of tiling window manager, you can focus. You can get from the ls command. You can get the ID of the window, the OS window, and then you can tell your tiling window manager to switch to that. So you just write a script to do. Or you can, if you don't want to use a tiling window manager, I mean, you can use tabs instead. So tabs work the same as that. So you know, you have one session per tab, and you use a focus tab command right here, and you can do whatever you like. I mean, you can build your own workflow. So there are no ready-made workflows for this in Kitty, at least at the moment. But the basic building blocks are there, and you can use them to compose your own workflow. So I kind of like that because, you know, I have different workflows for different scenarios. You know, one size doesn't fit all the scenarios. So I, in Kitty, my philosophy is to give you the building blocks, give you the remote control protocol and a tool to, you know, control Kitty, and then you build it, use it, you know, use it however you like. I mean, in fact, remote control doesn't just work within Kitty. You can use it from outside Kitty. You can even do it over a TCP port. So you can do it from a different computer in your house. I mean, you can possibly design this. So all that is built into Kitty, and you know, those building blocks are there, so you can.
Do you talk to the Tmux maintainer for compatibility when you try to deploy something new? Do you have communication? What's his name? I don't remember his name. But
I did try, but he wasn't interested, so I don't anymore. Now I just, so when I make something new,